could have put off all the things I had to do. I would have stayed a little longer, held on a little tighter. Now what I'd give for one more day with you. Cause there's a wound here in my heart where something's missing. And they tell me that it's gonna heal with time. But I know you're in a place where all your wounds have been erased. And knowing yours are healed is healing mine.
The only scars in heaven won't belong to me and you. There'll be no such thing.
Only scars in heaven won't belong.
You'll turn in your Bibles tonight to John chapter 10, John chapter 10, and we are going to be talking tonight about the Good Shepherd. Let me just, as you're turning there, share with you again about the Baptist Collegiate Ministries. I shared with you last week, you might remember, in the morning service, I shared about the revival that has taken place there with 100 students making professions of faith this school year with 40 students being going on mission trips, 30 students being called into ministry, Bible studies all over the campus. I think there's 26 discipleship groups and 30-some Bible studies, or it might be the other way around, but still, that's amazing. Student-led, this is student-led. And so the BCM has grown by 30%, and they are in budgetary trouble because they're trying to keep up with this growth. That's a good problem to have. That means something's happening. God's working. God's moving. And so this morning, somebody, and I have no idea who, it doesn't matter who, but somebody gave a significant gift of $1,000 to go to the BCM. So just wanting you to know that if God burdens your heart, lays it on your heart to give to that, that is certainly commendable, and we will make sure that the BCM, every bit of that money will go to them. If you give that. And then also, Rachel is so passionate about this that she's willing to give up some of the youth budget money to go to that because she's figured out how she could make that happen. And the youth are also going to take up a little collection, I believe, and And, of course, they probably won't get $1,000, but whatever they give, they'll be given from their heart, and the Lord will bless that. So just think about that as the days go on. I'm just excited that God is moving in that way, and God's moving here in our midst. We're blessed, and so let's keep that in mind as we move ahead. Well, as you look at John chapter 10 tonight, we're talking about the Good Shepherd. And I'm going to read 14 verses, so you can just remain seated while we read these. I would love to read the entire chapter, all the way to 30, actually. Not maybe the whole chapter, but all the way to verse 30, but I'm not going to do that to you. But I will refer to some of these, maybe, as we go on. So, beginning with verse 1 in chapter 10. Most assuredly, I say to you, he who does not enter the sheepfold by the door, but climbs up some other way, the same is a thief and a robber. But he who enters by the door is the shepherd of the sheep. To him the doorkeeper opens, and the sheep hear his voice, and he calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. And when he brings out his own sheep, he goes before them, and the sheep follow him, for they know his voice. Yet they will by no means follow a stranger, but will flee from him, for they do not know the voice of strangers. Jesus used this illustration, but they did not understand the things which he spoke to them. Then Jesus said to them again, "Most assuredly I say to you, I am the door of the sheep. All who ever came before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep did not hear them. I am the door. If anyone enters by me, he will be saved and will go in and out and find pasture. The thief does not come except to steal and to kill and to destroy. I have come that they may have life and that they may have it more abundantly. I'm the good shepherd. The good shepherd gives his life for the sheep. But a hireling, he who is not the shepherd, one who does not own the sheep, sees the wolf coming and leaves the sheep and flees. And the wolf catches the sheep and scatters them. The hireling flees because he's a hireling and does not care about the sheep. I am the good shepherd, and I know my sheep and am known by my own." Pray with me. Heavenly Father, we thank you tonight that we have a good shepherd. We're not all alone on this rock in the universe. You shepherd us, and you guard us, you protect us, you provide for us. And Father, we're very thankful for that. I pray that tonight, if we are discouraged, or we are weary, or we are afraid, or we're in need of some spiritual provision, or even physical provision, that we will remember that we are the sheep of your pasture, and we'll be comforted by that fact. We thank you for speaking to us tonight, and we know you're going to continue to speak to us as we expound your word, and we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. I think in this passage, if you include verses 28 and 29, which we'll look at in a minute, you see that the shepherd protects, he provides, and he preserves. On three occasions in the New Testament, Jesus is referred to as a shepherd. In Hebrews 13:20, he's called the great shepherd. 1 Peter 5:14, he's called the chief shepherd. In John chapter 10, Jesus calls himself the good shepherd. And if you count Revelation 7:17, which says the lamb will be the shepherd, that's four occasions that Jesus is considered to be a shepherd in the New Testament. In the Old Testament, shepherding was an honorable profession. Abraham was a shepherd. Moses was a shepherd. David was a shepherd. Three great men of the faith, men that were revered and were looked up to. And the prophets had good things, and the psalmist had good things to say about shepherds. Isaiah said, "He will feed his flock like sheep." He also said, "All we like sheep have gone astray." Now, that's not a good thing about a shepherd, but referring to us as a sheep, as sheep. Psalm 100 verse 3 says, "We are the sheep of his pasture." And Psalm 23 says, "The Lord is our shepherd." Well, if we are sheep and the Lord is our shepherd, we know that it is his job to guide us, to give us leadership, to give us direction, to give us protection, to give us provision, to make sure that we are secure, to make sure that we are preserved. When we know Christ as the good shepherd, The phenomenal thing is we no longer think that we live by chance. We don't have to go around shaking the magic eight ball to find out what's going to happen to us. We don't have to go to the psychic reader or read the horoscope. We know that we are in the hands of the Good Shepherd. We don't have to trust the world system to save us because we are the sheep of His pasture. He is the Good Shepherd. We have a Good Shepherd who cares for His sheep. And as I said, John chapter 10 shows us the way He does that. He protects us. He provides for us. He preserves us. So first of all, in verses 1 through 6, in the first five verses, Jesus is trying to give them this illustration, but they don't get it. They don't understand it. And so Jesus explains it to them following verse 6. But in the first six verses, Jesus talks about the shepherd protecting the sheep. He does it in several ways. First of all, the shepherd protects through leadership. And notice the shepherd doesn't drive the sheep. The shepherd leads the sheep. And because the sheep trust the shepherd, and because the sheep know the shepherd's voice, because the sheep have no reason not to trust the shepherd, they follow him. And he leads them in the right place in the best way. He leads them to the best place in the right way. Psalm 32:8 says, I will instruct you in the way you should go. I will counsel you and watch over you. And how many times has God, the Good Shepherd, Jesus, the Good Shepherd, how many times has He spoken to your heart and told you which direction to go? How many times have you not known exactly what to do and you've gone to the Word and you've read something and it's as if God wrote it in the sky for you? You knew what you needed to do, or He brought somebody into your life at just the right time who said something to you. God was shepherding you. Psalm 23 said, He leads me beside the still waters. He leads me in paths of righteousness. And even in the shadow of death, I fear no evil. Why? Because the Good Shepherd is with me. So there's protection from danger. He's watching over you. He is surrounding you. In verse 1, he says, He who does not enter the sheepfold by the door, but climbs up some other way, the same is a thief and a robber. Jesus is saying here that there is a sheepfold that has been built for His sheep, that they are protected. Now, in that day, a sheepfold was a walled area that sometimes was attached to a house, sometimes attached to a structure, sometimes just a walled place where you would take the sheep in at night. And sometimes that wall could be as tall as 10 feet high, and many times more than one herd of sheep would be kept into that walled area. And sometimes there would be a hired keeper who would be kept as the doorkeeper and would be paid to be the doorkeeper. But many times it was the shepherd whose job was to lay down across that opening, and anything that got to the sheep had to go across the shepherd. No one or no thing got into the sheepfold without first going through the shepherd or the shepherd's appointed gatekeeper. And so a sheep, because he's been so well taken care of by his shepherd, a sheep trusts his shepherd. And Jesus says that in verses 3 and 5 that the sheep will not follow a stranger. They listen to the voice of the shepherd. He says that the shepherd leads his flock. And he says in verse 4 that the sheep follow. When a shepherd would call his herd, and of course even today, and John Allen's told about seeing this over there in the Middle East, but even today when shepherds call their herds, the sheep separate out to their own shepherd. There's an intimacy there that comes from knowledge of being with the shepherd and hearing the shepherd's voice and trusting the shepherd. There's a story in about a sheep thief in Australia. And he'd stole a man's sheep, and he was sued for that or taken to court for that. And he swore up and down that this was his sheep. This is my sheep. I didn't steal this sheep. It's my sheep. And so the wise judge said, bring the man to the front of the courtroom and bring the sheep into the courtroom. And so they brought the man to the front of the courtroom, and he said, now, call your sheep. And he called the sheep, and the sheep just looked up and looked around and acted frightened. He wouldn't move.
And he said, bring the man in who says it's his really his sheep. And he brought that man in, and the man called the sheep, and the story goes that the sheep ran straight to him. And the judge said, his sheep knows him. This man's no thief. Case closed. The sheep know the shepherd's voice. A shepherd was asked one time if sheep would follow someone besides their true shepherd. And here's what the shepherd said. He said, sometimes if a sheep gets sick, it'll follow anyone. Now, that's a great parallel to the Christian life. When we get away from the shepherd and we get sin sick, or when we get emotionally sick and we're just not listening the way we used to, we'll follow the wrong shepherd. And let me say to you that the enemy wants to shepherd your soul too. But he wants to shepherd your soul for destruction. He's got a place for you too, but it's not a pen of protection. It's a place of bondage where he wants to lock you up and keep you from being free and keep you from being the man or woman of God that he wants you to be. And Jesus points this out. He says the thief or the robber does not come in the right way. He finds another way in. Jesus is very upfront and open and says, here I am. I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. But the thief and the robber comes to you and throws all kinds of things at you and says, if you'll do this or do that, you'll be happier than you will in following God. The thief's primary purpose, we see in verse 10, is not for your protection. It's not for your goodness. But the thief's primary purpose is violence, to steal and to kill and to destroy. And Jesus goes on to say in verse 11, he's the good shepherd, and the good shepherd lays down his life for his sheep. So the shepherd stands between you and the thief. The shepherd is our protection. He cares versus the hireling who runs away, who doesn't care about the sheep, but only is concerned about his own life. You know, the Bible is full of passages that remind us of God's protection and watch care over us, even as a shepherd. But one that's particularly beautiful to me is Psalm 27, where David says, the Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? When the wicked came against me to eat up my flesh, my enemies and my foes, they stumbled and fell. Though an army may encamp against me, my heart shall not fear. Though war may rise against me, in this I will be confident. One thing I have desired of the Lord, that will I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life to behold the beauty of the Lord. And he goes on and on. But why dwell in the house of the Lord? Because in the place, in the presence of the Lord, there is safety. There is protection. Over in Romans chapter 8, verses 38 and 39, he says, I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other created thing shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. He's talking about spiritual protection. So the shepherd protects. The second thing we see is that the shepherd provides. Jesus then explains in plain language, which we've already looked at a few things that he said in verses 7 through 13, but he explains in plain language what he's been telling them. And he tells them what the shepherd does for them. First of all, he says in verse 9, he is the door. He is the way into God's fold. Jesus is the only way into the fold of God. Again, I mentioned a minute ago, John 14, 6. I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. There's two things about Christianity that sets it apart from all the other religions of the world. First of all is that statement. There is no other, quote-unquote, religious leader who has made such a statement, that Jesus says, I am the only way to the Father. And the second thing that sets Christianity apart from all other religions is grace. We're saved by grace through faith, that not of ourselves, not of works, so that no one can boast. So the first thing that he provides for us is salvation. He provides for the sheep, the shepherd provides for the sheep, a place to go for safety, which is protection, but it's also their salvation. He also, he says, allows them to come in and go out and find pasture. This is a picture of freedom from fear. Because they're protected, they can come and go as they please, and they don't worry about what's going to happen to them because they know the shepherd's not far behind. Their needs will be met. And then he says in verse 10 that he has come to give life and give it more abundantly, or come that they might have life and have it more abundantly. He gives an abundant, full, rich, satisfying life now. He doesn't say to the sheep, once we get to our destination, you'll have an abundant life. He says he gives you an abundant life now. Eternal life begins the moment that you put your trust in Christ as your Savior, and then he gives you abundant life on top of that. And he lays down his life because he cares for the sheep and because he came for the sheep to seek and to save that which was lost. So he goes up against any foe to protect the sheep from the enemy. And we think of David when he was going to fight Goliath, and he talked about how he had to fight off the lion and the bear when he was a shepherd. That terminology that's used there for abundant life, the word for abundant means this: superabundant, excessive, overflowing, surplus, over and above, more than enough, profuse, extraordinary, more than sufficient. And that same word is used over in Mark chapter 6, verse 51, when Mark says this. This is when Jesus walks on the water. In verse 51, it says, then he went up into the boat to them, and the wind ceased, and they were greatly amazed in themselves beyond measure and marveled. They were abundantly amazed. And then over in Ephesians chapter 3, verse 20, it talks about how he is able to do exceedingly more than we ask or think. And so there again, he's using that word abundant. He doesn't just provide our necessities. He goes above and beyond. How many of you tonight could say that God has given you more than you deserve? And God has given you more than you need. How many times have you had so much left over, not just in your physical life, but even in your spiritual life? As you get into the Word of God, sometimes I get to studying for a sermon, and man, if I brought everything in here that I learned and everything I read, we'd be here for days just on one passage. God just gives you so much as you begin to glean from His Word. And so in our spiritual lives, He gives us so much so that not only does He give us all of that, but He knows us each so well individually and personally and intimately. I read somewhere that a shepherd gets to know his sheep so well that he knows their peculiarities and he knows their defects. Christ knows everything about the sheep in his pasture, in his flock. The very hairs of your head are numbered. You don't do anything or go through anything that he doesn't notice. And so that child who's being bullied in school, Jesus notices that. That teacher who goes the extra mile and does something to encourage maybe that same child, Jesus notices that. That hurt that you felt when you were younger, or that hurt that you felt in your family, or your doubts, your fears, your weaknesses, your conflicts, your defeats, your victories, your joys, your burdens, Jesus as the shepherd knows all of that, and he provides a soothing balm to your soul. And then here's the thing I love so much. He preserves. Let's go to verse 27 of chapter 10. He said, my sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. And I give them eternal life, and they shall never perish, neither shall anyone snatch them out of my hand. My Father, who has given them to me, is greater than all, and no one is able to snatch them out of my Father's hand. I and my Father are one. Now, first of all, I want you to notice the ownership here. He says that these are his sheep. They are my sheep, he says. Now, if you have something, and little children, they start this as soon as they know how to talk. They learn several words, no and mine. And so when you get something that's theirs, they want to protect it. Now, they may not have wanted anything to do with it till you pick it up. And then that's mine. And they are protected. And we do that our whole lives. We go through our whole lives saying this stuff is ours. We get deeds to prove it's ours. And we mark boundary lines to prove it's ours. And we get titles to things to prove it's ours. And we put our names on things to prove it's ours. Some people even put their name on their underwear to prove it's theirs when they go to camp. I don't know why that is, but anyway, they do that. And so we want everybody to know that this is my stuff, and you don't mess with my stuff because it's my stuff. Now, if we as humans are that protective over stuff that is not going to last, how much more so do you think God is protective of his sheep that he bought and he paid for with the blood of his son Jesus? So there's ownership. They're my sheep. He takes care of his possession, and those sheep follow him. That makes them very special. And one of the reasons they follow him is because in John chapter 6, it says that they have been drawn to him. The Holy Spirit has drawn them to him. And so they have come to him and they're going to follow him. And then he goes on to say that they will have eternal life and shall never perish. I don't know how much more emphatic you can get than that. Eternal life means life forever, and never perish means you never perish. And if anybody wants to do anything to you to try to destroy you, if the enemy wants to get to you, he has to go through the Father, because he says in verse 29, my Father who has given them to me is greater than all, and no one is able to snatch them out of my Father's hand. 2 Corinthians 1:22 says that he put his seal on us and gave us his Spirit in our hearts as a guarantee. So not only does he put us in a position where you've got to go through the Father to get to us, but then on top of that, he seals us with the Holy Spirit. Over in Ephesians chapter 1, verses 13 and 14, it says, in him you also trusted after you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom also, having believed, you were sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise, who is the guarantee of our inheritance until the redemption of the purchased possession to the praise of his glory. That is one of the most outstanding statements in all the New Testament. So the enemy has to go through the Father, and when he gets to the Father, you are, according to Colossians 3, hidden with Christ in God, and you are sealed by the Holy Spirit. That just sounds there like a situation where nobody's going to be able to get to you. It would be like today if we took a document and we sealed it with a wax seal, and we gave it to the special forces, and we sent the special forces down to the bank, and they put themselves in a vault, and they hid the sealed envelope in a container in the vault, and in order to get to the letter, you've got to get in the vault, get past the special forces, and find the letter, and that's the only way you'll be able to get it, and then you have to break the seal. That's how secure we are in Christ. Does that not make you excited? I mean, you lay down at night and you know, I've put my trust in Christ. I've truly believed in Christ, and so if I have a widowmaker heart attack tonight, praise God, I'll wake up in heaven. I won't have to vote in the election. I mean, won't it be wonderful? Here's what the final thing. Baptist Faith and Message 2000 says this about preservation. or eternal security. All true believers endure to the end. See, that's the problem. Not everybody's a true believer. But all true believers endure to the end. Those whom God has accepted in Christ and sanctified by His Spirit will never fall away from the state of grace, but shall persevere to the end. Believers may fall into sin through neglect and temptation, whereby they grieve the Spirit, impair their graces and comforts, and bring reproach on the cause of Christ and temporal judgments on themselves, yet they shall be kept by the power of God through faith unto salvation. Do you know that tonight? Do you have that confidence tonight? And if you do, praise God for that. And if you don't, you can get that confidence tonight, because the Bible says, whoever calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Are you a true believer? If you're not, would you come tonight and say, I want to be? So as we have our invitational...